Out in New South Wales, we've just seen the Health Minister and the Chief Health Officer, Dr. Kerry Chant. Here's Gladys Berejiklian now.
Good morning, everybody. In the last week, we had 750,000 people who came forward to get vaccinated in New South Wales, and we're inching ever so much closer to that 70% double dose figure, which is so encouraging. Can I please encourage everybody to come forward and vaccinated? And those of you who haven't, please make sure you book so that we can get to that 70% double dose as quickly as possible. To 8 p.m. last night, there were 1,281 cases of community transmission in New South Wales, and regrettably, five people lost their lives, and we extend our deepest condolences to their loved ones. Late last week, I received modelling on when our health experts think the peak will hit in terms of the number of cases, what the ICU requirements might be, and what the number of people in hospital might be. And I'm pleased to say that today we'll be making all of that public, but I do want to qualify all of that to say that modelling depends on a number of things, a number of variables. And if too many of us do the wrong thing and there are too many super spreading events, we could see those numbers not be what they are. But I do want to stress the following, that today Dr. Chant will outline that we have 177 patients in our intensive care units with COVID. At any given time in our hospital system, there'd be around 400 people with non-COVID related issues in ICU. And so our surge capacity, including staff, in our intensive care units is 1,550. So just to give people that reassurance, we certainly don't want to have to use all those beds and that staff, because we know what a pressure it will put on the system. But I want everybody to be reassured that the capacity is there. And today I'm pleased to say that we have Susan Pearce, who's Deputy Director General of the Department of Health, to talk about those operational issues. And Dr. Nguyen, who is one of our specialists, who actually put together the plan. To talk about the 18 months worth of planning that's gone on to ensure that we have a surge capacity of 1,550 beds in intensive care. All those figures are now publicly available, so all of our citizens can look at what we have today, what we look like, what we think we'll have. And according to the modelling that I've received, we're likely to reach a peak in cases in the next week or so. That's what the modelling tells us, and therefore a likely peak in intensive care beds required around early to mid-October. So that's what the best modelling tells us at this stage, but I do want to qualify that by saying that a number of variables are associated with that modelling. And I'm really pleased and grateful that Dr. Nguyen has made herself available today again to explain to us all the planning that's been involved, all the staff retraining, all the allocation of resources, and also a status report. Whilst things are stretched now, we appreciate they're going to have additional pressure put on the system in the next few weeks. And I just want to, again, thank all of our hospital staff, every single staff member, whether they're medically trained or otherwise, who keep our hospitals going in advance, as well as our ambulance and paramedic staff, who will be required to work together, as they do every day in our health system, to support the community at that time. But as Dr. Chant and the Minister and myself say almost every day, the best way we can keep people out of hospital, out of our intensive care units, is by getting vaccinated. And we've already seen what a difference vaccination makes. The higher the vaccination rate, the lower number of proportion of people who'll end up in hospital, and that's certainly what we'd like to see emerge in the next few weeks. So I'll ask Dr. Chant now to give the health update, then Deputy Premier will talk about the regions, Susan Pearce from Health will talk about the operational changes or the operational imperatives that we've put in place to cope with the additional cases in hospital, and then Dr. Nguyen, as a clinician, as an expert, will talk about the plan and all that's gone into it to make sure that we have that surge capacity available. Thank you.
There were 1,281 locally acquired cases of COVID reported to New South Wales in the 24 hours to 8 p.m. last night, and one overseas acquired case. 136,455 tests, so pleasing to see the community continues to respond to our request to get tested and get tested early. There are about 11,000 people with COVID who are currently being cared for by New South Wales Health. And we have about 1,071 COVID cases admitted to hospital, 177 people in intensive care, 67 of whom require ventilation. They span all age groups, and it is critical that we understand that COVID presents risk across all age groups, so please get vaccinated. In terms of the deaths, sadly, we have been notified of five people who have passed away. A man in his 90s from southeastern Sydney died at St George Hospital, and he was a resident of the St George Aged Care Facility in Bexley and acquired his infection there. He was fully vaccinated, but he had significant underlying conditions. There was a woman in her 80s from northern Sydney who died at Ryde Hospital. She had received one dose of a COVID vaccine but also had significant underlying conditions. A woman in her 50s from western Sydney died at Westmead Hospital. She was not vaccinated. And a woman in her 80s from western Sydney died at Westmead Hospital. And again, she was not vaccinated. And there was a gentleman in his 60s who died. The case has been referred to the coroner. He did test positive on post after his death through the coronial process, and we're still getting details about that case. So my key message is please get vaccinated, please get tested early, and seek help when you need it. Even if you've done something that you think is a breach of the public health orders, even if you're concerned about anything, please do not know that we will not care about what you have done. Health is caring about you, and our priority will be providing you with care. So please get tested early, and seek care early. There is a sewage detection in Byron Bay, and again, call forward the community for testing. And in terms of suburbs of concern, Greenacre, Georges Hall, Auburn, Bankstown, Dubbo, Bass Hill, Guildford, Merrylands, Punchbowl, Blacktown and Yuguna. I'm also calling out Central Coast and some areas in Wollongong. We're also seeing cases. So it is important that no one in the community is complacent. Case numbers outside the local government areas of concern are also increasing. So everyone needs to get tested if they have the most minimal of symptoms.
Good morning, and I start by offering my condolences to those families that lost loved ones overnight, and you remain in our thoughts and prayers. In Western New South Wales, up to 8 p.m. last night, there were 44 cases. 35 cases were in the Dubbo local government area, 6 cases in Bourke, 2 in Orange and 1 in Narromine. In the far west, 7 cases overnight, 6 in Broken Hill and 1 in Wilcannia. Southern New South Wales has seen an increase in cases as well. 3 cases in the Queanbeyan Googong area, 2 cases in Goulburn, and since 8 p.m. Last night, we've been already notified of an additional 2 cases in southern New South Wales, 1 in Batemans Bay and 1 in Cooma. In the Hunter New England area, 5 new cases, 1 in Port Stephens, 1 in Maitland, and 3 cases are from the Lake Macquarie local government area. The Illawarra Shoalhaven area is starting to be an area of concern. 21 cases all up, 9 cases in the Wollongong local government area, 8 cases in the Shoalhaven local government area, and 4 cases in the Shoal Harbour local government area. And again, 8 new cases on the Central Coast. Can I put a call out to the people and the community of Wee War and Narrabri? The Narrabri vaccination numbers were one of the lowest in the state. Over the weekend, the New South Wales government, in partnership with our local GPs, our pharmacists, set up walk-in clinics. Over 2 days, almost 1,000 people were vaccinated, and that is an unbelievable result for the communities of Wee War and Narrabri. We're still there today, and again, a call out to everybody to get vaccinated. Vaccination is the key to protect regional and rural communities from these outbreaks, more importantly, about our pathway for the future. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to make a couple of comments with respect to the hospital system before I hand to Dr. Nguyen. The health system throughout this pandemic has demonstrated time and time again that it can respond to the challenges that COVID has presented to us. We've been planning and preparing for this increase in cases since the start of the pandemic last year. And this will be an incredibly difficult and challenging time for our health system as we work through this. The plans that have been put in place, however, are only as good as the people who deliver them. And my message at the moment to the public is we have amazing health staff who are out there each and every day working really hard to deliver the best possible care to our patients, and we will continue to do that through this period. What we're experiencing now is not normal for our community, it's not normal for our hospital system, but we will get through this as the wonderful health system that we are and that we have always demonstrated we are for our community. My message is to reassure the community that anyone who requires ICU care during this period will get it, and it will be continued to be delivered by our exceptional staff who are out there working every day, as I said, to care for the many patients that we're looking after in hospital, but also those who are in the community. At least 90% of people with COVID are cared for in the community, and that's also a very important reminder. The Premier touched on the vaccination numbers for last week. So 750,000 across the state between New South Wales health clinics and our primary care partners, an amazing result. Over the last 3 weeks alone, New South Wales Health has given almost 1 million vaccines. We were given the challenge with that Pfizer that came from Poland to deliver all of that. We've done that, plus what was already booked in. I said at the time it would be challenging, but we got there, and I am so incredibly proud of everybody in the New South Wales health system who has contributed to that vaccination effort. If we want to see things change in our hospitals and the pressure on our hospitals and our ICUs, the best and most significant thing we can do now as a community is get vaccinated. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. So although the Premier sort of said that I was coming up to talk about my plan, needless to say, this has really been an effort of the whole team. And I want to sort of take you through, I guess, the journey of that team from March of last year. And if you remember sitting in your lounge rooms and seeing those images come through from Italy and New York of patients on ventilators in corridors, and our ICU and ED specialists overseas really sort of starting to highlight to us what the impact of COVID was on their health systems. It was about this time that myself and another advisors that were brought in to support the health response. And we knew that it was a call to arms, and we started off getting the equipment because we knew that a lot of our equipment required sort of shipping from overseas. You would have heard it well reported that we were aiming for the 2,000 ICU beds. And through March, we planned and we rallied. And through a strong public health response led by Dr. Chant and the whole of system sort of response, we breathed a sigh of relief in April, where we reached a maximum number of 50 patients in the intensive care and only 20 of them were ventilated. And then we spent all of 2020 continuing to build on our plans. And these plans systematically worked through all the things that we would need. We asked our colleagues at each of the hospitals to identify areas where they could set up an intensive care if needed. We asked them to identify staff who they could train and who they could bring in. And then when we had this little blip, actually probably more likely that we had the timelines, if you remember, we then had the surge in Victoria and we watched our Victorian colleagues deal with it. And I think importantly, what we did was we remained connected. And we were connected as clinicians at a state level and nationally and internationally. And that has really put us in good stead. So we asked all the hospitals to identify key areas where they might be able to set up intensive cares. And you've heard of projects that have been done at Royal Prince Alfred Hospital and North Shore as examples of the system and the hospitals and our staff getting ready. We know that at times the health system and our clinicians might feel a bit disconnected. But what became very clear was this connection and collaboration became crucial. And I can honestly say that our clinicians on the front line are the most connected they've ever been. So this connection is amongst, there's a lot of emphasis and a lot of attention to intensive care. But in fact, it's about the whole journey. We know that our ED clinicians and our respiratory clinicians on the wards and all those nurses and doctors who are looking after patients who aren't affected by COVID depend on us to collaborate and coordinate in order to respond. So what are some of the practical things we've been doing? As I've already talked about, we've gone and sort of identified areas, and each hospital has identified what their surge, so when we talk about surge capacity, it's an indication of which areas they could expand into. These are places like recovery or coronary care. We know, and you've heard this many times, and many clinicians will say to you, you can have as many ventilators as you like, but it's our highly skilled critical care nurses who operate the ventilators that we need. And I would echo Susan Pierce's advice to say it's all about our staff. Okay? And you would appreciate that ICU is a very critical care requires a very significant, a different skill set. But what we do know is our colleagues in operating theatres, our colleagues in ED, our colleagues in coronary care share some of those skills. There have been registers that have been set up to call for those who may no longer be working in intensive care, but could come and join the health response if they were needed. Our teams have continued to train and do simulations and other things at the hospital level. And the training has continued, and like I said, workforce will continue to be our biggest challenge. Earlier this year, we heard about the pandemic coming through the Delta wave, like through India. And although there was this lull over Christmas, and maybe, you know, so say there was all this work being done in the background, since about sort of March, April, we've started to ramp that up again. And we've been fortunate. None of those plans that we spent working on in 2020 had time to gather dust. We've been working on, we have a very good idea about where every ventilator is. We have these registers about our staffing. We're sharing resources in regards to education that through our communities of practice, which are in intensive care and many others throughout the whole health system. I think really importantly, we have really amazing visibility of where all our patients are across the health system. And when you hear stories of patients needing to be diverted elsewhere from either an ED, that's actually a sign that the system's working. Okay, the system's working because it's recognition that to provide the best and timely care for those patients is actually not at an ambulance, you know, in the driveway of an ED. It may be that it's to divert across the city. When we hear about reports that hospitals are going into crisis mode, it's actually that they said the system's working. We're continuing to learn when the right time is to divert, and we divert patients, and we won't always get that right. We've watched our colleagues in Western Sydney become under a lot of significant stress because of where the COVID patients have been. You hear about patients being transferred or intensive care patients being transferred across the city, down to Wollongong or across to North Shore. These are all signs that the system is working, and we're all here to help each other because the intensive care community recognises that patient care, the best patient care, occurs at the right place at the right time, considering all other factors from staffing to other sort of factors across the hospital. Our fundamental principle is that we should approach the intensive care as one whole unit. So you can imagine, you know, we talk about hospitals having big and small, but in fact, we're really an intensive care of over 500 beds, and the state's approaching it in that way. We will try and continue to share patients, like to move patients around and to bring staffing to those areas under strain. So we've been signalled over the last week that the numbers are going to rise. Does it worry us as a critical care community? Of course it does. Is this the biggest challenge that we're going to have as a health system? And will we be in crisis? I'm really confident that we have plans in place. Our critical care staff remain committed to providing the best and compassionate care that they can. Over the coming weeks, they may very well need to move to provide care in unfamiliar surroundings. We're going to be drawing on our specialists on the wards, particularly the respiratory disease, like the lung doctors, and you saw Dr. Morgan here last week describing the patients she was looking after in the wards. We know that there are nursing staff and medical staff who will feel a little bit uncomfortable with what they're being asked. But I'm really confident that we've got such a well-connected and supportive environment that patients will continue to get care when they need it. We've planned an intensive care advisory service. So this is a sort of a phone line that you can call to get expert advice if you you have both clinical issues or equipment issues. That's been established to determine if it's required. And we know, my phone's almost always on, very rarely off. And as a testament to the connections we have, we get texts and I get texts and we have mechanisms in order to feed that into the system. We're really fortunate to have an almost completely vaccinated workforce. And we have PPE available, which is important to provide to make our staff feel safe. So they turn up every day doing the jobs that they've been trained to do to care and serve the community. So over the coming weeks, we're going to continue to have to work on the plans we've made and refine them and really evaluate what's worked and what hasn't. And I think that what's really demonstrated, particularly over the last few months, how responsive the health system can be and how resilient our staff are and how committed they are to providing compassionate care. I can't emphasise enough, though, how difficult and exhausting this is going to be for our staff. So with an eye on providing best patient care, we're also looking out for each other. We're making sure that staff have adequate breaks and we make sure that they have time off. You'll hear stories and reflections from staff about having to work double shifts. Everyone is tired, we recognise that. But we check in and make sure everyone's okay. We're used to looking after critically ill patients, but our staff, the majority of them, will not be used to seeing the number of patients they're seeing at the moment and the number that are going to come through the doors. Many units across the city have really benefited from generous donations of food. It's mostly chocolates. You'll know that all intensive care staff love chocolates. And these have been things that seem small, but they've been important for the morale of our staff. Importantly, we've been really thankful for the community and their support for getting vaccinated. So although the projected numbers look challenging and frightening enough, we know that without vaccinations and without the public health orders, the numbers would be much worse. So every member of the broader health team are working hard to serve the community at the moment. There are many stories, like I said, of staff feeling tired. They're working long hours and extra shifts. And everything is taking longer because of the PPE they have to wear and the disconnection that they feel with their patients. But we're supporting each other in many ways. And together we'll get through this. Please help us by following public health orders and getting vaccinated as soon as you can. Thank you.
What is going to be the peak ICU demand, according to the modelling that you were given at the end of last week? Because this modelling here was released on the 25th of August.
The best modelling I received last Friday is an indication of what the numbers, the projections are likely to be. So what you have in front of you is the best and most recent advice I received on Thursday and Friday last week. Well, I'm just telling you that I asked for the up-to-date modelling last Thursday and Friday so that I could release it to the public. And what is there now is the best advice I have. It's in black and white. And can I please extend my deepest gratitude to Dr. Nguyen and her team, and it is a team, because what we've put in place reflects at least 18 months of hard work. And what it also reflects is the best estimate of our health experts. As we've seen in this pandemic, it's difficult to pinpoint every day what the numbers are going to be. But as I've also said, especially in the last few weeks, the most important numbers for us to look at are keeping a keen eye on that ICU capacity, because we know that surge capacity with staff, we have 2,000 ventilators, but when you're talking about beds themselves with staff and experts, we have 1,550 surge capacity, which we hope we won't use. In fact, there's a gap in our figures as to what we're likely to need and what we have available. We hope we won't get to that, but I hope it gives all of our citizens confidence that anybody who needs care in hospital will receive it from our outstanding staff, who will be doing it tough, but that's what they've been trained to do and prepared to do. But also, please know that the figures we've provided have a lot of variables. It depends on all of us doing the right thing. It depends on not having super spreading events. Any super spreading event can skew the figures. But I ask to have the best available. What you have in front of you is the best available advice that I have as the Premier, is the best available advice the New South Wales Government has. That's what we base our decisions on, and that's why we've made it public.
Premier, this estimates that the peak COVID ICU demand would get to 560. People in ICU right on November pretty much.